Professor Zimbardo, thank you for the vision of this conference. This is really incredible, and I'm so honored to be here. I'm a neuroscientist, and I'm a psychologist, and I'm going to talk to you today about some of my research. So my research program is largely revolves around better understanding the psychological biases that drive people to hostility and conflict between groups. And I'll be presenting some of my stuff today, but also some stuff from the field that I think is really relevant. So I come to this research program from my personal experiences. Actually, before I was a scientist, I was a real person, and I was a teacher for many years, and I would save up my money during the year, and I would travel during the summers. And mostly by happenstance, I just found myself in some really interesting places at interesting times. So I was in South Africa in 1994, when it transitioned from apartheid to democracy. I was in Sri Lanka right after I arrived. The Tamil Tigers blew up the international airport. I was in Ireland during the Troubles, and I've lived a couple of summers in Palestine and Israel doing research there. So what was remarkable to me as a budding scientist was how incredibly similar the conflicts were to each other. Now, these conflicts span three different continents, at least seven different religions, 12 different languages, and yet the things that I saw that were driving them were remarkably similar. There are, of course, the structural elements that are driving conflict, but what really struck me was how similar the psychological processes were that were driving people to continue the conflict. So, of course, an important question is, how do we get past these biases so that we can move people past this cycle of violence and conflict? And today, I'm going to present to you a little sprinkle of hope, followed by a big, meaty dish of despair, and then I'll come back around to hope at the very end, I promise. So first, the hope. There are hundreds of organizations and tens of thousands of people who are really committed to trying to resolve conflict between groups. These are some of the groups that are mostly just involved with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And this is hugely important. This is an amount of human capital, people willing to invest a huge amount of their own time and money to make the world a more peaceful place. And of course, we've heard from a lot of those people today. I dabbled in this a little bit, again, when I was a teacher. This is me with some of the kids at a camp. This is a conflict resolution camp in Ireland. This is me visiting some of the kids afterwards in Belfast. This was significant because it's both Catholic and Protestant kids, and they wanted to walk back and forth between the neighborhoods to collect their friends, which was actually quite risky at the time. But this picture that you would see in a brochure for this conflict resolution program has to be reconciled with what happened actually 2 weeks before this picture was taken. And that is when most of the volunteers had left and half of the kids were gone, a fight broke out between two of the boys, and it immediately split the group down partisan lines, and there was a 100-child full-scale brawl. So, of course, this is upsetting, right? This is a conflict resolution program. It's based on our common sense intuitions about what would work to resolve conflict. And I think this one, by any metric, a full-scale brawl is pretty much a full-scale failure. So this is where I dive into a little bit of despair, because that's not it. What I realized as a psychologist now is that this might not be a fluke. That there's something about our psychology that might lead us to lead our best intentions, our common sense, to fail more often than we would like. So my favorite example of this is not a conflict resolution intervention, but it's a common sense intervention trying to change people's behavior. This story takes place at the Petrified Forest in Arizona, in the US. At the Petrified Forest, there was this sign. So your heritage is being vandalized every day by theft losses of petrified wood of 14 tons a year, mostly a small piece at a time. And of course, good intentions. The idea here is based on common sense. You're trying to decrease this behavior by shocking people with the statistics. But a psychology student who was visiting here was completely appalled to see this sign, because that psychology student knows that our behaviors are really strongly influenced by descriptive norms. A descriptive norm is a description of what everybody else is doing. So in this sign, even though it includes this message of kind of shock, it also includes a norm. Everybody's doing it. So they weren't satisfied there. They wanted to actually run a study and see if this was true. So here's what they did. They created some signs, and they got the park to agree to rotate these signs through. One of the signs just had no norm attached to it. Please don't remove petrified wood from the park in order to preserve the natural state. And then the other one included a social norm. Many past visitors have removed petrified wood from the park, changing the natural state of the petrified forest. And then they just looked at how many of these little pieces of petrified wood were stolen. And this was done by graduate students painstakingly marking the back of tiny little pieces of petrified wood and then going out into the field and counting how many of those had been stolen when each of these was in place compared to a baseline with no sign. So here's the data. 3% of the petrified wood was stolen in the baseline condition. If they include the sign with no norm, it actually decreased the behavior. When they included the sign with the social norm associated with it, they almost tripled the amount of theft of petrified wood. Okay, so this is having an ironic effect. It's not that it's ineffective, it's that it's having the exact opposite effect than they intended. So now that you're cued into it, you will see these all over the place. Here is a really popular anti-littering sign in California that shows how many cigarette butts are littered and basically tells people that everybody's doing it, you shouldn't do it. A little more tragically, this is a US military leaflet drop over Somalia telling Somalis to stop being pirates by informing them that everybody is a pirate. And most tragically, in Africa, there's currently an anti-rape campaign that tries to prevent rape by depicting rape on the sides of buildings. So these things are powerful, but why? I think the reason is comes from how the brain works. And this is my favorite analogy of the human brain. The human brain is like a rider sitting on top of an elephant. And the rider represents that part of your brain that you're consciously aware of, whereas the elephant represents the large portion of your brain that's completely inaccessible to your introspection, that's the subconscious, the unconscious. So you can hear this, but I like to show it if I can. So I'm going to take a little bit of a risk and try a live demonstration. And I've already chosen my volunteer. Would you mind coming up? It's not... Okay. Yeah, I get to get you back.
Surprise.
Yeah. Okay, so here's the task. It's very simple. That's your target. You're going to be standing here with your back to the audience, and you're just going to start off by throwing a beanbag. Are you left-handed or right-handed?
Right.
Okay, so just throw the beanbag underhand into the... Okay, great. So just stand in the same place. You're going to be doing a lot of this. Okay, do it one more time. Okay, now I'm going to give you a little bit of assistance. I want you to put these goggles on. So go ahead and put them on. Okay. Okay, now go ahead and throw at the basket. Okay, nice. So turn around again so people can see it. Okay, so what you might see is that her eyes are shifted to you, and that's because inside the goggles there are prisms that shift her visual field about 20 degrees. So she just missed the basket by 20 degrees because that's exactly where she sees it. So she threw it exactly where she sees it. Okay, so this is what we're gonna do now. You're gonna keep the goggles on and go ahead and step back here and turn around. You're gonna just keep throwing these bean bags at the basket, and I don't want you to overthink it. Just let it come naturally. Just here, I'm gonna give you a bunch and just throw one by one. Just keep throwing nice and fast, yeah. Yeah, so don't try to correct or anything. Okay. Eventually it'll happen. Just trust it.
Keep going.
Okay, great. It takes a while, so keep going with it. Okay, so stay there for a second. Keep the goggles on.
All
keep
right.
the goggles Thank on. You. We're going to give you a little more time. Just take as many as you like. Yep, just keep going. Okay, now go ahead and, okay, here's the punchline. Go ahead and take off the goggles, and I'm gonna give you one beanbag, okay? And go ahead and throw it in the basket. Oh, wait, hold on. Throw it in the basket. Here. Okay, try it again, throw it in the basket.
It's scary.
Thank you.
Thank you.
She will recover, I promise. So this is called prism adaptation. And what this is illustrating is that her brain was learning something that she wasn't necessarily conscious of. She could observe it, but in the end there, were you trying to throw it in the basket? Of course. So, but it was the elephant that was now guiding her throws, and she missed to the other side, right? So a part of her brain had learned this behavior, and now it guided her behavior afterwards. So this is always happening, right? We have this large part of our brain that's learning these things implicitly beyond our conscious awareness, and that's what makes it particularly tricky. So here, this message, this common sense message, had an intended effect that was directed at the rider of the elephant, right? It was a moral appeal to not steal these pieces of petrified wood. But there was an unintended effect. There was a norm that was built in there, and the norm was appealing to the elephant without people being aware of it. And since we're generally unaware of the elephant as it's doing its thing, we discount how much effect it's going to have on our behavior. So in this case, the elephant had more of an effect than the rider. So the people might have felt that moral appeal, but the force was too strong on their unconscious brains. We also know some about the brain regions that are responsible for this. So let's see. So this is a brain, if you cut my head straight in half, that's right here, kind of between my eyes, called the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. It's a mouthful. It doesn't matter. It's just a brain region we have identified that codes for subjective value, how much you value something, even if you're not aware of how much you value it. Here's another example. This is from here. This is an actual intervention created by the World Bank. And the idea of this intervention is to try to convince Hungarians to support policies of Roma integration. And the argument goes something like this. This is the demographic curve of Budapest, right, of majority Hungarians. And you can see it's very typical of Western countries. That is, you have a bulge in the middle, and then you don't have very many people at the bottom because people don't have very many children. And this, of course, is a problem, right? Because as the population ages, you eventually get a group of people that are drawing pension and that need healthcare, and you don't have enough people supporting them. And there are a number of ways that you can solve this problem. Ceausescu tried this in Romania. Am I getting this name right? Okay, he tried this in Romania by forcing people to have more children. That didn't work very well. You can encourage immigration into a country. A lot of countries do it this way, so you swell the ranks of people at the bottom who can be productive members of your workforce. The World Bank was trying to convince something else. By showing people this demographic curve of Roma, you can see that there are a whole bunch of young Roma out there, and the argument here is that you should increase the efforts to educate and integrate the Roma into your community because they can either be your future workforce or they can be your future welfare recipients. Okay, so the intended effect here is, of course, it's about rational self-interest. This is why the World Bank created it. But obviously, this can also represent a threat. In fact, this is exactly the type of thing that we as psychologists use as what we call a threat prime, to prime someone to feel threatened maybe without them even realizing it. So my prediction that I'm testing soon, I don't have this data, but the prediction is that we know that threats in general cause people to be more authoritarian and to conform more, and also drives up their prejudice. So this is the exact type of common sense intervention that, again, might backfire. We also know something about the brain regions involved in threat and fear, and this is the amygdala. So now, if you cut my head straight in half this way, this is basically behind my sinus cavities, these two, the amygdala there. Here's a particular type of threat that's really relevant specifically to groups that are at the losing end of a stereotype. This is called stereotype threat. This is a type of threat that actually affects people's behavior every day. So in this study, what they did is they brought people into the lab, and this version of it, there's a mixed group like here of men and women, and they handed out a test to everybody. They were just really hard math problems. And in one group of people, they told them, these are just a series of games. And when they do that, just a series of games, they find that men and women perform equally on this task, right? They get the same score. With another group of people, again, mixed men and women, they bring them in and they give them the same exact test, but this time they tell them that the test is diagnostic of their natural mathematical abilities. And when they do this, they get a completely different effect. That is a decrease in the performance of women doing this task. Now, you can do all sorts of versions of this. They've done a version of this where they have Asian women in the US do this, and if they ask them to report their ethnic identity before taking the test as Asian, they outperform the men. And if they ask them to report their gender before the test, woman, then they underperform the men. So you can push people around in every direction here. And it's a really powerful effect. So this, again, is a type of threat that's maybe activating the amygdala. The amygdala is very good at getting you out of tight scrapes, of getting you away from a lion that's chasing you, but it's really bad at taking SATs. So here's the first step towards getting back to hope. We're definitely not gonna be there yet. The hope is that we have ways now to measure what's going on in the elephant directly, well, indirectly and directly. So the first way is with reaction time tasks. And I'll show you the most popular one of these. This is the implicit association test. And how this works is if you have a computer in front of you, you have people put one finger on either button on either side of the screen. You tell them, okay, you have two different categories, one on each side, and words are going to come up in the middle, Arab names and American names. I want you to press the right button if it's an Arab name and the left button if it's an American name. And the task is to do this as quickly as you possibly can. So it's a reaction time task while making as few errors as possible. So we're going to do this. So we don't have buttons on a computer, but the way we can do it is just put your hands on your two legs. And so when a word comes up that's of the category on the left, human, right? or the category on the right, animal, if it's just the word, you just slap your leg and we'll be able to hear the response. So here we go. Okay, easy, right? Okay, now we're just gonna change the categories, but the task is exactly the same. So here we go, but this time we're gonna have faces. So you're gonna have to do your best to recognize this. And I should mention that in the real IAT, you would have done that a gazillion times. So you're familiar with all the words, you have 40 trials, so it gets really comfortable to you. Same thing with the faces. Here we go. Okay, now we're just going to put them together. So same categories, now they're just going to be mixed together. Okay, you ready? Here we go. Okay, so I did this with 150 Hungarian teachers in training, and they're about like you, a little bit less than a second for reaction time. Here's the real meat of the task, though. So this is what you were just doing. All we're going to do now is we're going to switch the category pairs. Now, normally, I would give you a bunch of time to, again, practice with each of these, but I'm going to cheat and go right to the cut right to the chase. So you're going to do the same task now. It's just that the categories are now associated with each other differently. Okay, you ready? Here we go. Okay, so I set you up for failure here, so your times would be worse, but the teachers in training, there was about a 25% lag. They were 25% slower in doing that pairing than the previous pairing. So incidentally, it doesn't matter whether I did the pairing of Magyar and Animal first or second. You get the same results either way. And as a comparison, I also ran this with Americans, with Arabs and human, Arab, animal. And I got this is how we generally put up these scores. This takes into account both the variability in the population and how big the effect was. So this is an American community sample, and these are the Hungarian student teachers. So you can see that that there's a pretty strong effect of the strong association with Roma and animals in Hungary. Okay, so that's one way to test our implicit associations, our unconscious associations. Another one that I'm really excited about is, of course, neuroimaging. Now, you can ignore the goofy grin, but this is what I do with a lot of my time is I put people in a scanner and I look directly at their brains as I make them do rather uncomfortable things. So here's one task where I just ask people to control their emotional responses, and you can see our friends, the amygdala there. So the red is where you get more activity when you're not trying to control, and when you try to control your emotional responses, you actually decrease activity in the amygdala. And how it's been used for intergroups research is they've just had people in the U.S., white participants in the U.S., look at pictures of white faces and black faces, and then they looked at the response in the amygdala. So here's how they present the results. So one interesting thing here is the 30 milliseconds. That means that you're flashing the face on the screen so fast that people aren't even consciously aware that they've seen it. So this is going directly to the elephant without the rider even knowing that what's going on. And what you see is there's a stronger response in the amygdala to African-American faces versus white American faces, and it's particularly strong if they aren't even aware that they're seeing it. So what's interesting here is that the reason why it might decrease when you see it for longer is that you can consciously control the response in the amygdala, just like I showed with that previous slide. Okay, so there are ways to measure implicit bias. It's important also to recognize that the rider matters as well. And one bias that I've been particularly interested in measuring explicitly, directly, is dehumanization. Of course, the reason for this is that dehumanization has been associated in the past with so many atrocities, from the dehumanization of Jews before and during the Holocaust, to the dehumanization of the Irish before the colonization of Ireland and killing of a third of their population. But it seems to be alive and well now also. So, of course, there's the incidence of throwing bananas down onto the field at African football players, and this is, I think, my favorite. This is a cute little onesie for your baby that has a picture of President Obama with a chimpanzee photoshopped on his shoulders. And you can actually purchase this online. So here's what we did. We developed a measure of complete, overt, direct dehumanization, and then asked around the world, but also in Hungary, for people to respond to this measure. What we did is we just gave them the ascent of man diagram, listed a bunch of groups underneath, and asked them to report how far over each of those groups were on the ascent of man scale. And here are the average responses we got from a representative sample in Hungary. So these are people from Budapest, people from Transylvania, Muslims. I should mention that this was done a year and a half ago. I have a prediction about how that particular one might have changed over time. And then here's the Roma. So this is a 29-point difference on this 100-point scale. I also had the teachers in training complete this, and they reported a little bit less, but still a pretty high difference between these groups. For the Hungarian teachers in training, I also wanted to look at their actual behavior. So in this task, I just gave them, you'll notice that the two profiles, the 100 points, I've realized is a mistake. It's out of 50 points, your standardized tests, I believe. Anyways, the profiles are exactly the same. It's just that one profile has a name that's more associated with Roma, and the other one a name that's typically non-Roma. And the question was, so half of the teachers saw one of these, half the teachers saw the other. The question was, would they place them differently into the different school tracks? So here are the responses here, and this is just how appropriate they thought each of these school tracks were for the students. So if it was a non-Roma, a Magyar student, then they thought they were most suited for the kind of middle track. And if it was a Roma student, then they were more suited for the lowest track. And importantly, when I asked the teachers afterwards, not me, when the research assistants asked the teachers afterwards in Hungarian, if they had a different profile, so they saw one profile, if they had seen the other profile, did they think they would have placed the student any differently? They generally said no. A few said yes, I would have applied affirmative action. Only one of them said that they would favor the non-Roma student over the Roma student. So this apparently is happening, you know, maybe without their conscious awareness. And the last piece was the most important to me. This was in a new group of teachers. I wanted to see, okay, well, so teachers blatantly dehumanize the Roma. They also report less compassion and less warmth towards the Roma. But which one of these is actually driving the behavior? Which one of these is actually driving the bias? So the first column is going to be a number. The higher the number, the stronger the association between that measure and their bias in the placement. And the next column, is just how likely that is to be due to chance. So higher numbers in the first column means stronger association. Lower numbers in the second column means, yes, this is probably true. And what we see is, interestingly, the only one that predicted this was this blatant dehumanization, that it didn't really matter how the teachers reported feeling towards the Roma, their affect towards the Roma. It was how much they blatantly dehumanized them. So, of course, Hungary does not have a monopoly on dehumanization. This is a process that historically has been really common. We see it in the U.S., specifically towards Muslims and Arabs. Here are some of the scores. These scores are now from the last month, so these are very recent. In Spain, quite high up here, and this is probably predictable from the rhetoric coming from Denmark, and down in Greece. Okay, so this is across Europe, and of course, one of the reasons why I think this is really important to track and pay attention to is that dehumanization is typically used to morally disengage from the suffering of another group. If they're not human, then the normal rules of morality don't apply to them anymore. And so you can remove the moral restraints, and this is thought to be why it's so commonly associated with atrocities. So, now we can come back a little bit to hope. Because there is something we can do about this. There's something that we can do about the unconscious processes that are going on, the things that are driving the elephant itself. One is on stereotype threat. So remember, stereotype threat is this threat that decreases actual performance, probably by activating the amygdala and kind of distracting you from the reasoning centers of the brain that are very good at taking these types of math tests. So in this same paradigm, they actually had one extra condition. And this one extra condition, they still told the group of people that it was a diagnostic test, but this time, before they took the test, they took 5 minutes to teach them about stereotype threat. So just what I showed you here, that if you're the losing end of a stereotype, it can affect your performance, but it's just the stereotype. If they teach them about it beforehand, it completely eliminates the effect. And this has been replicated across different cultures. So this, to me, is remarkable. This is saying that just an awareness of a process that's going on in your brain can inoculate you against experiencing it. And this is incredibly hopeful to me. We don't actually know, of all the psychological biases that we've characterized really well, we don't know which ones we can inoculate against and which ones we can't. Presumably some of them will work really well, some will work less well. But with such a simple intervention, this is really promising. And I think this also speaks to the fact that I have a favorite quote from Buddha, which is, the thought becomes the word becomes the deed becomes habit, and habit hardens into character. And to me, this means that you can take these things that are implicitly going on and you can pull them into your conscious awareness and gain some control over them. And that's the hopeful lesson, I think, of neuroscience, is that our brains are incredibly flexible and the things that are going on automatically can be pulled into the conscious awareness. So there's very little that we don't have control over if we just commit to it. There's some other good news. There are other interventions that we can address. Remember, this one was about a norm, an unintended effect of a norm. Well, some people have started using norms to directly affect the elephant, just acknowledging that they have this huge effect. Here's one that was used to change people's environmental behaviors. So this is a door hanger. I don't know if you have this phenomenon in Europe, but in the US, people will sometimes take these little hangers and hang them on your front door so that when you come in, you see a little message there. And as you imagine, these are very quickly trashed. So it's very unlikely that many people will see it. At most, maybe one person in the household would see it. So this is a very subtle manipulation. They just hung these things on the door, and you see that it just enforces a positive norm now this time. They're trying to push people in this direction by telling them that 99% of your neighbors think that turning off the lights to save energy when you leave the house is a good idea. So they had a bunch of different signs. You know, some of them talked about social responsibility. It's a good idea to conserve energy. Another of the hangers said it's in your own economic self-interest, it conserves energy so that you don't pay as much. And then another one was just information unrelated to this. And what they found was just this, hanging this on the wall, they actually went to people's homes and saw how much energy they consumed a month later. And a month later, there was a measurable decrease in the amount of energy consumption in the households that had that little hanger on their door. And this, again, this is incredible. This is such a subtle manipulation that must have reached a fraction of the people that they were actually trying to get to, and it has a measurable effect. And finally, media. So media, of course, is always playing on our unconscious kind of associations with other groups, and we can design media that will push us in the other direction, that will make us aware of racism, for example. One really exciting technique that I'm hoping to employ very soon is taking this a step further. Instead of just, again, relying on our intuition of which one of these anti-racism media interventions will work, I want to test them out in a subset of people first. This has been done already by my friend Emily Falk, who I'm collaborating with now, and she did it with anti-smoking campaigns, and this is what she did. She brought people into the lab. They were all smokers and they had an intention to quit. And she showed them different anti-smoking ads. So the ad A was the dark comedy. So this is a woman is smoking alone in her bed at night. It's raining outside. She's in the second story flat. And in a fit, she throws her cigarette out the window. And then there's a 2 second pause and then she jumps out the window after it. Okay, so a bunch of commercials like that, right, of that vein. And B was the totally depressing one. So this is like showing people what lungs look like of chronic smokers and how terrible it is to be addicted. And then C was this kind of campy one. It was cartoon cigarettes talking to each other about how they were going to hook their human on nicotine. Right, so very different campaigns, and the question was which one of these will work, and typically you just get a focus group in there, so she used them just as a focus group. She asked them, which one do you think will be most effective? They gave their responses. They thought the really dramatic one would work best, but then she put them in the scanner, and she asked, again, this part of their brain, the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, right, the part that codes for your subjective value, she asked their brains which ones they valued the most, and the responses were completely different. And then the final piece was she got New Jersey to agree to rotate through these ads and just record how many people called into the 1-800-QUIT number. And she found that the call volume was predicted by the brains and not by their explicit responses. Okay, so this is a technique that I'm hoping to use to test out, for example, different messages about Islamophobia to see which one beforehand, which one might be most effective. Okay, so that's it. Just in summary, I gave you this analogy that I think is really powerful about the human brain being a rider on top of an elephant. I talked about explicit measures that we can use, implicit measures based on reaction time. And then I talked about different interventions that can be really effective and really easy to deploy. And finally, how I see neuroimaging potentially fitting in here and informing this process. So, with that, thank you, and appreciate your time.